In this video, we will get you started off with Next-Gen Corda. I will start off by talking about the architecture of Next-Gen Corda, and then we will look at how to develop a simple token Corda app. At the end, I will deploy a local Corda cluster and show you how to run your Corda app. One of the most powerful features of Next-Gen Corda, I would say, scaling. How do we make sure that we'll be able to easily scale up and down based on the current load? How do we make sure that we always run Corda in a highly reliable way? And how do we make sure that we can support multi-tenancy and easily scale the number of nodes? In Corda 4, one node is one identity. It's a single JVM process and is a single monolithic node. CorDapp is installed on a node in Corda 4. AMQP is used for peer-to-peer communication. Corda client has to be a JVM process if you want to, let's say, integrate your current application with Corda. As one JVM is one node, in order to increase the throughput, you will have to have a bigger JVM. Since one node is one JVM, we cannot have an active failover. We cannot have a hot architecture because of technical reasons. The best possible availability scenario is hot-cold, that is an active standby scenario. The failover will incur some downtime. In next generation Corda, we have used a message bus architecture using Kafka. Next-gen Corda introduced the concept of worker nodes, which are basically stateless processes. On the left, you can see a pile of work, which can be picked up by any worker. If the load increases, more workers can be added as and when required. And when the load reduces, we can reduce the workers. Adding and removing workers can easily be done by Kubernetes, which is basically a preferred deployment strategy for Next-Gen Corda. Here, we have two workers. If any worker dies for some reason, its load is taken up by the other worker. Of course, the throughput can decrease in such a situation. In Corda 4, a process has to be up for the node to be available, regardless of whether it's processing any flow or not. So if Carol has to process, let's say, one message a day, that process has to stay up the entire time to listen for the message coming in. With Next-Gen Corda, this changes. We have the concept of a cluster with Next-Gen Corda. A cluster can have more than one virtual nodes. Virtual nodes are tied to an application network and an identity. Application network membership is managed by MGM, which is in itself a virtual node. A Corda cluster is network agnostic, that is, it can support multiple virtual nodes belonging to different networks. So as you can see in the diagram, Alice and Carol are part of the same application network. They're interacting with David, who's part of some other application network, but still they are co-hosted in the same cluster. We've seen how workers scale, but why do we have different types of workers and how do they work? And how do they work with virtual nodes? Next-Gen Corda is built around a Kafka message bus. Here, we have a cluster of stateless Corda workers running in a hot config. Nodes are now virtual nodes, that is, they are not tied to a specific JVM process or a physical CPU, but you can think of virtual nodes as an execution context. It's not a thing anymore. This virtual node by itself in a distributed environment is not useful unless they interact with other peers on the network. We no longer use AMQP Artemis for peer-to-peer communication, and now we use HTTPS for peer-to-peer communication. All the interaction to the node from the outside world, like requesting to start a flow or node administration, all of this is exposed via a REST API. Hence, from your client application, whichever language it's being written in, it can easily communicate with the Corda cluster over HTTPS or even using an HTTP client. Internally, there are different workers which focus on some specific tasks. It's all about segregating relevant work to relevant workers. Each worker has a certain privilege which other workers don't have. For example, the DB worker is the only process which can read and write to a database. the crypto worker is the only worker which can access the private keys to sign the transactions. We can even combine all the workers in one single JVM process. That's the combined worker concept, which we will use for our day-to-day development and testing. I'm going to focus on DB worker and flow worker as it's quite relevant to a Corda app developer. A Corda app in Next-Gen Corda is still a jar file. It needs to be hosted in a runtime, in a host process. So how do we do that? How is it related to virtual nodes? Here, I've got highly available flow and DB workers. I've got certain virtual nodes as well. Again, a virtual node is not a single JVM process, but an execution context. To elaborate a bit more, a virtual node is an identity combined with an application, that is a CorDapp. Workers are agnostic to what work is being put on the message bus. So one flow worker can pick up the work from Alice, let's say for CBDC app, or it can also pick up the work for Bob for settlement Corda. Since we have multiple workers, each worker can simultaneously take up the work from Alice and Bob. Since the workers are completely agnostic of the work which is being put on the message bus, even if there is less green work for Bob and more purple work for Alice, it's okay. The cluster will scale on an aggregate level and is not specific to a specific virtual node. Let's take a look at this example, which shows how things work. Let's imagine we have a single instance of flow and DB worker. We've created two virtual nodes, Alice and Bob. Alice is associated with the CBDC Corda app and Bob is associated with settlement Corda. Now, virtual nodes are created using the exposed REST API, but here, let's just assume that virtual nodes are already created in this cluster. Let's imagine a flow start request comes in via HTTP RPC API and this request is put on the message bus. This message gets picked up by a flow worker who creates a sandbox execution context and loads Alice's Corda app into this sandbox execution context. At this point of time, I can say that Alice's virtual node is running and has the CBDC Corda app currently loaded. Let's say that the flow needs to save a token to the database. As we've seen earlier, we have separated these concerns and hence the flow worker doesn't have access to the database. So it puts a save token instruction to Kafka message bus. At this point of time, the flow is checkpointed and this current flow worker is freed up to do some other work. This instruction is picked up by the DB worker. DB worker identifies that the message is in the context of Alice and loads the CBDC jars in a sandbox environment. It will save the token to Alice's vault. It then sends a signal back to the message bus, which gets picked up by any available flow work at that point of time, and the flow continues. In Next-Gen Corda, Corda platform is a jar. CorDapp is also a jar, similar to Corda 4. It has to be hosted in a host process. For example, here, we are hosting it in the flow worker. There are a number of things that can happen over here. Example, your Corda app can use a third-party library, let's say commons.jar. It might happen that commons.jar will be used by corda.jar. And hence, there could be a dependency clash with the host. Sandboxing saves us from this situation. Previously, there could be a clash if some other Corda app also uses the same jar, but sandboxing now will prevent this as well. Apart from third-party libraries, it might happen that a class in one Corda app can conflict with a class from other Corda app. Their package name and class name might be same. But again, sandboxing will solve this problem as well. Now let's take a look at how our Corda app is built, distributed, and installed. Next-Gen Corda apps are similar to Corda 4. It consists of workflow and contract jar. Now what we do here is we bundle the contract jar with its dependencies into a CPK file and we do the same for the workflow jar. Individually, these CPK files are of no use and hence what we do, we bundle them together to what we call a CPB file. This consists of all the required CPKs including any third-party dependency CPKs wrapped in a one single bundle. The important thing to note over here is that the dependency resolution happens at build time and not at runtime. Now, a CPP cannot be installed on a cluster directly. This is where the network operator comes in. The network operator takes the CPP file, links it to a group policy file. This file references a particular network. These two combined basically is called as a CPI file. Now it's very easy to create multiple CPI files, one for the QA network, one for the production network. The CPP remains the same, only the network information will change. Now how does the CPI get installed onto the cluster? Using REST API, the CPI can be installed to a cluster. Once the CPI is installed on the cluster, the application is available to the cluster. It's equivalent to you putting your application on App Store. But still, anyone is not still using it. Cluster operator creates a virtual node. Now, at this point of time, we have the virtual node created. But it's still not useful until everyone on the network knows that it's available for interaction. Hence, the virtual node will be registered with MGM, where the virtual node or Alice will request MGM to join the network. Once the MGM approves, Alice will be able to participate in the network transactions. That's how a Corda cluster looks like. We spoke about workers. We have different types of workers separating operational concern. Each worker can easily scale. We have the concept of virtual nodes and application networks. They are not processes or things. So virtual nodes are not processes or things, but they are a combination of an identity and a Corda app, which is tied to a specific application network. We spoke about sandboxing and how it fits into the entire Next-Gen Corda architecture. We also spoke about the all-in-one combined worker architecture, which can be used for day-to-day development and testing.